You can see there are a lot of vague terminology used in the definitions. The first acceptable clinical definition was proposed by Masters and Johnson, and they define PE as the inability of a man to delay ejaculation long enough for his partner to reach orgasm on 50% of the intercourse attempt. A very good afternoon to all. First of all, I would like to thank the organizers for giving me an opportunity to present this topic. Coming to the topic proper, I'll be discussing under the following heading: introduction, premature ejaculation diagnosis, various definitions, challenges in the diagnosis, and proposed diagnostic criteria. As you all know, premature ejaculation is a common male sexual dysfunction. It's also, the recent terminology is early ejaculation, and PE was reported in medical literature years back in 1987, and the first acceptable clinical definition was proposed by Master and Johnson. Coming to the diagnosis, usually we used to get a history of rapid ejaculation, and depending upon the onset of symptom, if it is from the beginning of sexual life, it's lifelong PE, or later it is acquired, and depending upon the scenario, it can be situational or global, and there can be associated erectile dysfunction. And in the history, we have to ask about the patient's and the partner's perception. What is the approximate time between penetration and ejaculation? About the severity of the problem and its impact on life, like is it annoying you or your partner? And about the perceived degree of control over ejaculation. Are you able to delay ejaculation? And also take a proper history of associated medical illness, psychological or psychiatric illness, and history of drug intake or history of any surgery, trauma, etc. So PE is a self-reported problem. It not only affects the patient, but his partner also. And PE lead to various psychological issues like anxiety, depression, relationship issues, etc. And to quantify the early ejaculation, the term used is intravaginal ejaculatory latency time. It is the time interval between vaginal penetration and intravaginal ejaculation, usually measured with stopwatch, and the median IELT is 5.4 minutes. So physical examination include proper examination of abdomen and genitalia, neurological examination, and if there is associated painful ejaculation, we have to do rectal examination also. And majority of the time, the examinations will be within normal limit, but it will give reassurance to the patient that they are anatomically normal. So in most of the criteria and most of the literature, three components are required to diagnose premature ejaculation. The first one is short ejaculatory latency time, inability to control ejaculation, and psychological distress associated with that. Coming to the classification, there are mainly four types of premature ejaculation described: primary or lifelong, acquired, natural or variable, and subjective PE. So in lifelong PE, it's due to genetic or neurological factors; acquired PE due to psychological or psychiatric illness, associated medical illness, or relationship issues. And normal PE is a normal variance of sexual performance. And subjective PE, it's a cultural or psychological perception with imagined rapid ejaculation. And in IELT, that is intravaginal ejaculatory time, it's in lifelong PE, it is within 30 to 60 seconds or between 1 to 2 minutes. In acquired PE, it is described as short, less than 3 minutes usually. And in normal or variable PE, sorry, natural or variable PE, it is short or normal. And in subjective PE, it is normal or longer. And the onset is from the first sexual encounter in lifelong PE, at some point in man's sexual life in acquired PE, and variable PE, it is inconsistent, and in people with subjective PE, it is subjective perception of rapid ejaculation. So it can also be classified into generalized or situational PE, and depending upon the severity, mild, moderate, or severe. Now we will see various definitions of premature ejaculation. You can see there are a lot of vague terminology used in the definitions. The first acceptable clinical definition was proposed by Masters and Johnson, and they define PE as the inability of a man to delay ejaculation long enough for his partner to reach orgasm on 50% of the intercourse attempt. American Urological Association defined PE as an ejaculation that occurs sooner than desired, either before or shortly after penetration, causing distress to either one or both partners. European Association of Urology defined PE as inability to control ejaculation for sufficient length of time. And the ICD class definition is the inability to control ejaculation sufficiently for both partners to enjoy sexual interaction. And the ISSM definition is ejaculation that always or nearly always occurs prior to or within about 1 minute of vaginal penetration from the first sexual experience, that is lifelong, and the time cutoff is 1 minute, or a clinically significant and bothersome reduction in latency, often about 3 minutes or less, that is for acquired PE, and it is associated with the inability to delay the ejaculation in all or nearly all vaginal penetrations, and that leads to negative personal consequences like distress. And this is the DSM-5 definition. It's a persistent or recurrent pattern of ejaculation occurring during partnered sexual activity within approximately 1 minute following vaginal penetration before the individual wishes it. The symptom must have been present for at least 6 months and must be experienced on all or almost all the occasions of sexual activity, and the symptom cause clinically significant distress in individual. And the sexual dysfunction is not better explained by a non-sexual mental disorder or as a consequence of severe relationship distress or other significant stressors or not attributable to the effect of a substance or medication or another medical condition. So these are the various definitions of premature ejaculation. You can see that all these definitions contain various vague terminologies like bothersome reduction in latency time, before the individual wishes it, clinically significant distress. So most of the currently available definitions contain a lot of subjective components, which can be varied as per the perception of the clinician and the patient. So clinician always look for a criteria which is simple and practical and which can be easily applied. With this background, we propose the criteria for the diagnosis of premature ejaculation, which contain 4 components: subjective component, objective criteria, and frequency duration criteria and exclusion criteria. So before going to the criteria, we will analyze each component. Subjective criteria: the symptoms suggestive of early ejaculation resulting in sexual discomfort or dissatisfaction is the central component of PE diagnosis. See, other component described are inability to control ejaculation and psychological distress associated with premature ejaculation. The inability to delay ejaculation is a contributing factor for PE, so hence it is not considered as an essential component in making the diagnosis of PE. So, and it is difficult to gather correct information regarding ejaculatory control from the patient. Similarly, negative personal consequences like distress, anxiety, these depends upon various factors like personal, socio-cultural, and interpersonal relationship. So these features indicate the impact of PE on a person's life. So it is also not included as an essential component in the diagnosis of PE. Coming to the objective criteria, we can either use IELTS, that is intravaginal ejaculatory latency time, or NITBE, that is number of intravaginal thrusts before ejaculation. As we already discussed, IELT is the time between vaginal penetration and intravaginal ejaculation. It's usually measured with a stopwatch handled by a female partner, and the median value is 5.4. IELT less than 1 minute is defined as severe PE, less than 1 to 2 minutes is moderate, and 2 to 3 is mild PE. The stopwatch IELT estimation is difficult in the clinic, and most of the time, clinician has to rely on self-estimated IELT, which is often found to be inaccurate. Thank you. Most people consider stopwatch ILT measurement as an intrusive and disrupting the sexual pleasure and spontaneity. Measurement of ELT, which is used to define early ejaculation, is inconvenient for a significant proportion of couples and not very accurate. These are the limitations of IELT measurement. The next objective component is the number of intravaginal thrusts before ejaculation. So it can also be used as an objective criteria. And the average time required for one intravaginal thrust is found to be between 0.8 to 1.4 seconds. Hence, the average number of intravaginal thrusts in 1 minute varies from 42 to 75. So the number of intravaginal thrusts before ejaculation less than 42, which correspond to 1 minute in the other definition, that is IELT definition, indicates severe PE, and between 43 and 84, moderate PE, and between 85 and 126, a mild PE. NITBE is more convenient, and some experts consider that it is a better indicator than IELT to define PE. But not only the number of thrusts, but also the speed of thrust influence ejaculation. The speed of intravaginal thrust is not uniform throughout the intercourse, and it becomes faster towards ejaculation, limiting the use of NITBE as an objective component. The other objective criteria is significant or persistent reduction in either IELT or NITBE from the previous status is also included as an objective criteria. And if there is a significant or persistent reduction, it indicates that it is acquired PE. And the frequency duration criteria says that early ejaculation occurring in most of the occasions, that is more than 75% of the occasion, for at least 6 months is required to diagnose PE. And if the frequency duration criteria is not satisfying, it comes under early premature ejaculation, transient early premature ejaculation, transient early ejaculation or transient premature ejaculation. And exclusion criteria, the exclusion of non-sexual mental disorder, consequence of relationship issues, other medical disorder has to be ruled out before making the diagnosis of PE. So coming to the criteria proper, so in the proposed criteria, there is a subjective criteria. Subjective criteria, there are two components, essential component and non-essential component criteria. That essential criteria include early ejaculation resulting in sexual dysfunction in one or both partner, and non-essential criteria is inability to delay ejaculation and negative personal consequences. Objective criteria, four component, either one, if present, it can be taken as positive. Short IELT, less than 1 minute, severe, 1 to 2 minute, moderate, and 2 to 3 minute, mild. Or significant or persistent reduction in IELT from the previous status. And number of intravaginal thrusts before ejaculation, less than 42 severe, 43 to 84 moderate, and 85 to 126 mild. And significant and persistent reduction in NITBE from the previous status. Frequency duration criteria affecting majority of the sexual intercourse, more than 75 for at least 6 months period. And exclusion criteria, exclusion of conditions that will better explain the sexual dysfunction. So coming to the interpretation, you can see the subjective criteria, objective criteria, frequency duration criteria, and exclusion criteria. If all these are satisfied, it is confirmed PE. Then we have to see if it started from the beginning of sexual life or after a period of normal sexual life. If it is from the beginning of sexual life, it is lifelong PE. If it is after a period of normal sexual life, it is acquired PE. But in most of the time in our clinical practice, we are not measuring IELT or number of thrusts. So in such cases, we can say that it is probable PE because we cannot differentiate PE from subjective PE if we are not measuring objective criteria, that is IELT or number of thrusts. And those who are having essential criteria without objective criteria comes under subjective PE, and those who are satisfying essential criteria with objective criteria without frequency duration criteria, that means all other factors are there, but the frequency duration criteria is not satisfying, it is transient PE, and variable PE is one of the classic example of transient PE. And if there is no symptoms, that is essential criteria is absent, but objective criteria is present, and it comes under asymptomatic PE, such individuals are usually recognized when we are doing some clinical research or community studies to assess the PE, otherwise they are not coming to our clinical picture. And the criteria we published in Men's Health Journal last year, so diagnosis of PE is challenging because of the lack of clear-cut diagnostic criteria, and we hope that the proposed criteria will help the clinician to make diagnosis of premature ejaculation in day-to-day practice easily. To conclude, it's a common sexual problem. Diagnosis is clinical, and the proposed criteria will be helpful to make a diagnosis of PE. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Ravindran, for a very informative talk in a short span of time. The forum is open only for 3 questions, as we are running short of time, please.
The role of the trust is the male partner or female partner?
Sir, there are a lot of defect in calculating both intravaginal and this one. But some literature says that both can do, and some says that female partner. Because it should not interfere with, because we are assessing the male's performance, so it should not interfere with the male's performance. That is why some of the literature says that female has to count.
Okay. In treatment part, mild, moderate, severe, how you will treat the...
Sir, there is one more thing. The severity is not not for the treatment. And another issue is that the severity is defined based on the IELT duration. That is less than 1 minute, 1 to 2 minute, and 2 to 3 minutes. And see, in patients with acquired PE and lifelong PE, those who are having acquired PE are having more symptoms and more distress compared to those who are having lifelong PE. But if you compare the IELT duration, lifelong PE people have less IELT. So the duration of, or the time to ejaculation is not the not directly related to the symptom severity. So that is one issue with the classification of mild, moderate, severe. And one more thing, all the guidelines like ISSM all included 1 minute for acquired PE, lifelong PE, and 3 minutes for acquired PE. But ideally, when we are defining a disease, the criteria has to be same. So you cannot say that he's having lifelong PE, so his cutoff is 1 minute and the other fellow's cutoff is 3 minutes. So when we are defining a disease, it has to be a uniform parameter, because it affects the sexual partner also. So the female partner may be normal in both cases, no?
Sir, thank you for wonderful presentation, sir. Though I'm deviating from the topic, sir, but you are medicine expert, that's why I'm asking. Sir, apart from this SSRI, psychotherapy, and the relaxing therapy, do you have any experience with these alpha blockers and drugs like tapentadol for PME?
No, sir.
Because now they have started proposing all these drugs. Many times we do have patients where nothing is working, and they are proposing all these drugs as well for this PME.
Dr. Ravindran, good. Do you really believe that counting is possible during the thrust or either by the partner or this way? So they cannot complete the sexual response cycle, they will lose the erection.
Sir, that is correct. It will interfere with the normal sexual activity, but there is no other objective parameter to define this. So even with this difficulty, we have to...
It has to be CCTV camera, and then we can...
Sir, this is last question.
Sir, how you can measure the speed, sir, please? How
that,
you can measure the
speed? That is what I'm telling, sir.
1, 2, 3, 4, get on the dance floor, like that.
Sir, how you can measure the speed?
Sir, that is what I'm telling. So,
I think Dr. Murugan, there should be a scorer, lay empire, and camera also. 3 things should be there. Okay, third empire.
Spectator. Smartwatch.
Sir, please. I already got it.
I invite Dr. Ruma Shukla ma'am to felicitate Dr. Ravindran.